Hi, welcome to my WeHo World in this edition of 28 Minutes. My name is Darren Timothy Newmer, and filming for us today is Randy Lemons. Thank you, Randy, for filming. But more than that, thank you, Jan and Joel, so much over there at my WeHo World and giving us this opportunity for another 28 Minutes. Today we're doing a special with our guest, who you're going to find out who he is in just a second. His name is Mark Pine. He is the deputy director here at the observatory and has been here, I think, 15, 16 years or something. We're going to find out. We're going to ask him how long he's been out here. But he said that he would meet us here at 2 o'clock, and right now it's 2 o'clock, so I think we're going to be seeing him coming up this sidewalk in a little bit. If you want to take a look at this statue, look at this in front of the observatory. Is that not amazing? We have Herschel back in 1738 to 1822, Newton 1642 to 1727, Kepler, his date, oh my goodness, 1571 to 1630, Galileo, wow, am I getting this right? 1564 to 1642. Well, all these men were absolutely instrumental in the Griffith Observatory. Look behind you, Randy, who we have. Mark Pine.
Nice. Good to see you. Good
Hi.
To see you.
How are you, sir?
I'm excellent. How are you?
Wonderful.
Well, welcome to the observatory.
Thank you. Did you hear that? He said, welcome to the observatory. We are going to be with you for the next 28 minutes, and we want to know everything about you and what you do here. But in the beginning, can we just hang out in the front and talk a little bit about yourself and who you are and what you do here?
Absolutely. Let's see. Who am I? I'm Mark Pine. I'm the deputy director of the observatory. I started with the observatory as a volunteer with Friends of the Observatory in 1997. And since then, I've gone through a number of incarnations in my relationship with the building, but always been associated with it because I love it.
How long have you been working here, that is?
I've been working here as an employee for the last 7 years for the city of Los Angeles. Prior to that, I was an employee of Friends of the Observatory. Prior to that, I was a volunteer for Friends of the Observatory.
Actually, that's one of our questions that our producers had. That's FOTO, right?
It is. It's FOTO, and they've been around since 1978. They are our partners. This is a public-private partnership. The city owns and operates the observatory, but FOTO is our indispensable private nonprofit membership organization. We couldn't get by without them.
So we're going to start with you, and without even looking at my questions, it showed in college you had an interest in politics and in science. Well, how'd you go there? Which one did you choose, and how'd you choose it?
I was going to college for political science and actually got nervous when I was signing up freshman year for my classes that if I only had a political science degree, I would have to either be a lawyer or sell shoes. And I don't like buying shoes, and I'm not particularly interested in going to law school. So I immediately went through the catalog and picked out a second major. As it happens, I went alphabetically. And while I started looking for astronomy, my school didn't classify it as astronomy. They classified it as physics. So I never got to it. The next thing was broadcast journalism. I thought, I love to talk. So, and there you go. About the worst possible way one could make to choose their what they're going to study for 4 years in college, but that's what I did. And while I don't use it, I find the training that I got in doing it incredibly valuable because it helps you with public speaking, it helps you with organizing your thoughts, what's the most important thing, and that has benefited me in every job I've ever had.
Do me a favor. Jet Propulsion Labs. Talk to us about that.
Okay, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory is actually someplace right here in Southern California, over in La Cañada, up against the hills. It's the NASA Field Center that does all the Mars exploration, all the outer planetary exploration. It does Earth remote sensing. It does technology development for space sensors. A lot of that technology is now evolved into things that we use in our daily lives. Things like the sensor that measures your temperature of your body by putting something for 3 seconds into your ear.
Wicked.
Which is a little different than the way we had fevers mentioned when we were children. And better, I would venture to say. And so they are the leaders of that kind of exploration. So every time something big is happening on Mars, it's a pretty sure bet that JPL is involved. And it was wonderful to work there. The people there are you know, they're super smart and they're solving some really hard issues. How do you get a spacecraft to go 100 million miles and then soft land on another planet and drive around for a year, or in the case of the Opportunity rover, for 10 years, and have it all work when you can't walk up to it and fix something that's broken? You have to do it remotely.
And through science, I take it, you know this. You understand how it works.
You do. Well, science and engineering. You figure out how to engineer a rover or a device or an instrument so that it'll operate on a planet where the temperature fluctuates 100 degrees a day, mm-hmm. or where there's almost no oxygen in the atmosphere and the pressure is so much lower than here, and in any number of other differences between, you know, what we're used to here on Earth and take for granted and other planets where things are much, much more unforgiving.
What's sure. over here?
Okay, that is the solar telescope. That's what we call the Coelestat. It is the most, more people have seen the magnified view of the sun, the surface of the sun, on that instrument than any other in the world. In the middle of the building, foreground is the cupola. If we stepped back farther in the background, you would see a much larger dome, which is the planetarium dome,
right on.
Which is where we do planetarium shows that basically simulate the environment of the night sky, which most of us can't see because we live in Los Angeles where there's a lot of light pollution.
Right.
And then over here,
on
the left, is the Zeiss telescope dome, and that's the dome where we have our 12-inch public visible telescope, and every night about 400 people stand in line, and they actually walk up steps to look through that telescope. It is the most looked-through telescope in human history.
Thank you. You answered a question for me. I couldn't wait to ask you, can we, the public, go up and look through it?
That is actually the reason the building is here. Griffith, J. Griffith, the man who gave the money to create the building, had an experience on Mount Wilson, which is actually over there, although you can't see it today, unfortunately, in the San Gabriel Mountains. And it's a research observatory, and it was built in the early, early part of the 20th century. And Griffith went up there soon after it opened, and he looked through at the time, the largest telescope in the world, which was 60 inches.
Okay.
And he had a transformative experience and said, if all mankind could look through this telescope, it would change the world. And so he was determined that while recognizing that the public cannot all go up to Mount Wilson, because at the time the only way to get up there was on donkeys,
yes.
and that it's a research institution, so that's not what it does,
yes.
There needs to be a place where that transformative power of observation could occur. And so he left money in his will when he died in 1919 to build an observatory. And the will is actually very specific. It specifies that there has to be a public telescope. It specifies there has to be a science theater, which later became the planetarium. There have to be exhibits about science and astronomy in particular,
okay.
and that there has to be this location. In fact, the location he wanted was up there.
Directly
on
above.
On the top of what is Mount Hollywood.
Sure.
And when they brought architects on in 1931 to start planning out the project, one of the first thing the architects determined was, no, you cannot put a public building up there. It's bad enough that it's here in the sense of access, but it accomplishes, so they came to this compromise
sure.
with the trust.
They met in the middle.
And they met in the middle, but what this has is it has this overlook. And so if you go to the back of the building, land just drops away, and you have this spectacular view, as you can see around 360 degrees, of the Los Angeles Basin. And that's what Griffith wanted. He wanted people to observe and get the perspective that you get by being up high. Also, to get here, you have to actually make something of a trek.
Okay.
You have to drive through the park,
yep.
and you have to
sure.
drive up the hill, and you probably have to park far enough away that you have to walk a little ways.
Yes.
And so we have dreadful, dreadful cell and internet reception up here.
We found out, thank you.
but actually, you know, I'm sorry for the inconvenience to people, but from our standpoint, it actually serves our purpose, because in a connected world, for a moment, people actually get disconnected.
They need to be disconnected. Correct. To connect to what
Correct.
You're fixing to see.
Correct. And we like that, because Yes. then what you get is an experience. We are an institution that has lots of potential to educate people, but our real goal and our real passion is to inspire people.
Yes.
That's what Griffith wanted.
Yes.
That's what got him interested in this whole concept, and it's what the building is designed to do. It's designed to inspire people to ask a question, or something that people don't do much today, which is just walk out of the doors at the end of their visit and look up at the sky.
Yes.
People don't pay
Yes.
attention to the sky because they don't have to. In antiquity, people had to pay attention to the sky because it was part of their life. Nowadays, we want to try and reconnect people with the sky and the behavior of looking at the sky and, okay, what does it make you feel like when you
Right.
do?
Right. May I share with you, Randy, tell Mark what you got for Christmas.
My very first telescope.
What was that?
My very first telescope.
See, that's outstanding. And obviously, we have public telescope observing every night, and it's free. You can look through the Big Zeiss telescope. You can look at telescopes that are down here. Once a month, we have a public star party, and there's dozens of telescopes on the lawn for hours and hours and hours, and we get thousands of people who come up and look through them. Again, all for free. That was part of Griffith's deal, is that his money would pay for the building, and then the city would operate it in perpetuity, and that admission would always be free. And that is the way it has been since 1935.
That is so incredible.
First day I ever came here, which was in 91, and I was coming through Los Angeles, and somebody had the good sense to say, before you do anything else in Los Angeles, go up to the observatory and get a sense of the fact that Los Angeles is not Ohio.
So you go on up.
You go on up and you just have this, and the irony is that I had that experience, oh my gosh, this place is gigantic, and I didn't actually come inside.
You didn't?
No. And so it was then 6 more years before I came back here working at JPL.
No!
And met.
You waited 6 years.
I didn't know any better.
You're thinking about.
I also didn't live here, so that's part of my excuse. I didn't live in Los Angeles.
I did this with a comedy club.
I moved here in 97 and came up here soon thereafter and actually went inside.
Yeah,
and since then, I've really enjoyed the place. I more than enjoy it. I love the place.
Please take us inside and show us what you would love to show us.
Okay, let's go in. This is the edge of space. We're now underneath the front lawn.
Wow, look over the side.
Yes, you can look over the side and you can see into the Gunther depths of space. And we have models of the planets here lined up. And these planets are actually scaled correctly to each other. So you get a sense of just how big Saturn is relative to that little blue ball that's beyond Jupiter.
That's
the Earth.
Hey.
And you get a sense of the relative size. And again, that's what we went for, is we wanted people to have a sort of that transformative observation. Because we're an observatory. We're not a science center. Los Angeles has a fantastic science center, also free, I might add, and the space shuttle.
Nice.
So we don't need to do that job. What we do is we try to get people to be observers. And one of the things they can observe here is they can observe the relative sizes of the planets. They don't need to read a piece of text. They can just see them.
How many miles of miles?
Hello, I'm Albert Einstein. Or not.
Talking about Albert Einstein, if you notice the statue, who commissioned this? I love that statue.
We commissioned it. We wanted something to illustrate the humanity of the exhibit that's over on the wall here, which is called The Big Picture. It's the largest astronomical image ever produced. It's 150 feet long, it's 20 feet high, and the reason why Albert Einstein is doing this strange behavior here is that what The Big Picture is that if you look up at the night sky toward the constellation Virgo and you hold your finger like this about a foot away from your eye, that little rectangle of sky is what that giant wall represents, except as if your eyes were 36-inch telescopes. And so what you see on that wall is a million galaxies, each one just like the Milky Way that we live in. So you start to get a sense of the enormity of space. And so Albert Einstein is illustrating it is possible for people to understand that enormity, and he's giving people the sense of dimension of just what little tiny part of the sky all of that wall is about. And so it, and so we had a wonderfully talented firm in Brooklyn that made this statue for us, and it was the first exhibit that was done.
Hey, we just turned around a little bit and we're in a different position. Mark, would you please tell us, or are you allowed to share with us something that we don't know about the observatory?
Something that you don't know about the observatory? Well, I think something that most people don't know about the observatory is that it's actually owned and operated by the city of Los Angeles. This is a public observatory, and that sets it off. So first, it's for the public. It's not for research. Second, it's owned by the public. This is the people of Los Angeles. If you are a resident of the city of Los Angeles, your tax dollars pay for all of this to benefit everyone, and also pays my salary, so thank you. And those two things are very unusual, because that kind of an investment, and then the third thing is, and people find this when they arrive, is that it's free. And people are always saying, well, can we get special passes? And I'm like, no, you don't need a special pass. Your special pass is everyone's special pass.
Nice.
You walk through the door, you enjoy all of this. The only place that we have a charge is for the Samuel Ocean Planetarium, and it's a very modest charge. It's a lot less than most other places. And we think, and that gives us a visitor base that is actually exactly identical to Los Angeles. So you'll see everyone speaking every language of every color from every part of this region will come here, and they'll all get along and they'll have a good time. As a civic gathering place, that's not a bad thing.
We want to hear about the renovation process that was in 2002. Mark, could you please tell us? We heard that you gutted out the place.
We did, and it took 4 years. We were closed from 2002 to 2006, which was a long time to not be able to come here for those of us who loved the place.
What happened?
We needed to do a couple things. The building was 70 years old. It was in wonderful structural shape, but it needed new air systems and water and you know, electrical wiring. So it needed to be cleaned and fundamentally just sort of made as lustrous and beautiful as it was in 1935. So that was the restoration and renovation part. Then there was completely redoing the Samuel Ocean Planetarium.
The what?
The Samuel Ocean Planetarium.
Okay.
Then there was building an entire new exhibit program, which you've seen a little bit of today. And then the final part was we wanted to increase the amount of space that we had for our visitors and have a big new gallery that didn't have a lot of posts in it. And so we presented that idea to our architects, and they said, well, the building is visible from every corner of Los Angeles, so you can't add a structure onto the outside that's above ground. You need to go down. Well, on three sides we have hillside, so that's not an option. So the only place left was the front lawn, and so we went down 30 feet underneath the front lawn and dug out this gallery, and that led to also room for the Leonard Nimoy Event Horizon Theater, and then built the gallery and then put the lawn back on top of it. And so if you come up to the building, and film crews love this, if you come up to the building and you want to film, the building looks just like it did in 1935. And you can't really tell the difference. And so that's wonderful. And it's wonderful for our visitors because it's a historic building that Los Angeles preserved. It didn't get knocked down. It actually looks the way that it used to. So it's of the past. It's very much of the present. And a lot of the things in it also look a little bit like it's of the future. And so it's a lovely blend of the best of all of those periods.
What do you see for the future of Griffith Observatory?
The future of the observatory is, the renovation was about the future. It was making sure that this institution that serves the public would be there. It had been here for 70 years. We worked very hard to make sure it would be there for the next 70 years so that people can continue to come here, continue to be inspired. We're open 6 days a week. 10 to 12 hours a day. We're one of the few public places that's open until 10 o'clock every night. You can come here for free. Our parking is free. Weekdays are the best. And I just hope that people will come. And that the future is, our attendance has increased every year since we reopened. And I hope that that continues, because this place isn't doing its job unless there are people in it. And that's and we like it that way. Our guides, everywhere on the floor here, you will see people. Those are our employees, and their job is to help the people who come here have a great experience, whether it's answering a question, presenting a planetarium show, interpreting what you're looking at through a telescope, helping you to find your way to the bathroom.
Yes.
We have people helping people to have an observing experience.
Do you know one of your maintenance guys by the name of Alex?
I do.
Yeah.
He was actually out on the front lawn as we walked
in. Oh, you're kidding me. We saw Alex and didn't say hi to him. He's the one who instigated all of this.
We have wonderful employees, and I'm not surprised.
Awesome. Well, yeah. We love you, Alex. We love you, Christina. Thank you for helping get this interview going. Randy is talking to me. What's up, Randy?
Well, we're talking about, you know, what the Griffith Observatory does, and I think it would be nice if we talked about what it does for the kids that, you know, it's an educational place, right?
It absolutely is. You know, this is a place where you can get out of it whatever it is you want to. So if you're coming to learn something, there is an enormous amount to learn. If you're coming to educate your children about the nature of the universe, we're right here for you. If you're coming to be inspired by the wonder and the imagination of the cosmos, we've got that. The Samuel Ocean Planetarium is a transformative environment that gets people excited about big questions, and that's why, and we like that. We like the lack of cell phone service, and inside the building, it's even worse. So, you know, once people
turn
get inside, you don't have to turn your phones off. They'd have
no
connection. So, and that's good, because just for a moment, people will stop, and maybe they'll see something that will make them ponder some bigger question, and to just stop for a moment in their lives and have a contemplative moment, because we don't get those very much.
Let's say a silent prayer to everyone that someday we'll send telescopes over to these countries that keep fighting each other and send them to the children, because the children will change the world. But it's got to get sent first. I would like to ask you, can we have a no money system in the world? If so, when and how?
I'm probably not the best. I am sure that someday, in a time that I'm unlikely to see, that we will come to an ability to have resources distributed in a way that is fair, rational, and doesn't completely deplete them. When that time is, I don't know. How you get there, I would not even want to begin to try and think about. You know, I am sure that science, every aspect of society would have to be part of that kind of an undertaking. And, you know, on Star Trek, they have the replicators, not replicators, they have, what are they that makes the things out of nothing? They transform
simulators?
Oh my gosh, this is really bad. We're both Star Trek fans,
right?
And we can't think of this. So you'll get a lot of calls.
Where you go,
please don't call me.
Right, where you go into that room and
No, where Jean-Luc Picard says Earl Grey hot,
right,
and the thing produces it out of nothing.
I wouldn't know the name of that. Do you know the name of that, Randy?
Right.
All right, three nerds who are clueless.
Wow. This is a dark, dark moment for science fiction.
This is how spankings were invented.
It's unfortunate. Anyway, so I don't have a good answer to your question.
Bull crap. That was the greatest answer. You added way more than I was expecting. And you said it correctly. It will be through knowing how to distribute the amount of whatever we have to give to everyone equally and lovingly. I thought you did wonderful on that. We're running out of time here, and I'm really getting upset because I don't want to quit. Thank you so much for this interview.
You're very welcome. We're delighted to have people come here, and as you can see, I like talking about the observatory, and most of my job is administrative and making sure that our employees have the resources they need to do their job. So I don't get out on the floor as much as I'd like, and so this is fun. You know, I come back and I see all of the reasons why I like to work as hard as I do to make sure that the place does what it does for people.
I imagine your ears just must tickle.
It's a... I know how people like the place.
You can hear it.
Yeah. I mean, people come here and they're like I was. They're excited and they see something that's unexpected, and that's nice. That means we're doing our job.
Please keep up the great work for us.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
You're welcome. Thank you. Thank you, Jan and Joel of My WeHo World, again, for giving us this incredible opportunity. Thank you, Jan Foster and Joel Q, for giving us this wonderful opportunity for filming 28 Minutes. Thank you, Randy Lemons. You want to say hi to your mom?
Hi, Mom.
You want to say hi to anybody out there, your mom or dad? Or whoever?
I don't think they live in Ohio, so they're unlikely to see this, but I will say hi to anybody who knows me. Say come hi to the observatory.
Say hi, Mom and Dad. They're going
hi, Mom
it
and Dad.
And hi, Mom out there, too. I love you. And thank you, everyone in Los Angeles, for watching 28 Minutes.
Encourage people, if they love the observatory, if they want to support the observatory, join Friends of the Observatory. Their website is www.friendsoftheobservatory.org. It's very simple. Ours is griffithobservatory.org, and you can get to photo from our webpage as well.
Let me have your email again, or not your email. Give
no,
me your
please.
Yeah. His email is...
What?
Tell us your website.
www.griffithobservatory.org.
And once again, we want to say thank you, Mark, for letting us have all of this time that you gave to us. I know you're a very busy man here at the observatory, so we're going to say thank you, and we're going to say thank you, thank you, thank you.
You're welcome, you're welcome, you're welcome.